Welcome back to the show. We're leading the news at 9. At least 3,500 people have been killed in two earthquakes in Turkey and Syria.
As we go to air, thousands of rescuers are digging through the rubble trying to find any survivors. Many buried beneath collapsed buildings which were brought down in 120 aftershocks. Children among those being pulled to safety, as we're seeing right now, including this little girl in Syria.
Look, some light at the end of all of that darkness this morning. She has been reunited with her family, and fortunately she wasn't seriously hurt.
Such a relief.
Yeah, it sure is.
Well, journalist Melda Dogan joins us live from Adana in Turkey right now. Melda, thanks so much for your time. We know how difficult it is over there. Could you just bring us up to speed on what's happening where you are?
Hello, Sarah. Well, right behind me, this building that is almost flattened is one of the 5,606 buildings that flattened after the earthquake 4 a.m. morning local time yesterday. Rescue workers are still searching for any sign of anyone who could be alive under these rubbles here. Rescue operations has been ongoing since hours now, but still families and friends of those who are in 5,600 buildings across Turkey's south and southeastern region are still waiting to hear someone who could be alive. Well, so far we know in Turkey 1,762 people have lost their lives according to authorities, but unfortunately we expect this number to rise maybe in the upcoming hours. We hope it doesn't happen. While the authorities have quickly sent teams on the field, 10 cities have been affected in this earthquake. So we're talking about a large region in Turkey. And the building you see behind me, actually, interestingly, was still up and tall after the first earthquake, but it has demolished after the second one, which happened around noontime on Monday in Turkey. About 10,000 rescue workers are working, plus another 10,600 volunteers are on the field trying to find any survivors under the rubbles. It's a very sad day for Turkey now. We can say this is one of the biggest earthquakes we have witnessed in the last decades. Actually, President Erdogan said earlier that we have been shaken by the strongest disaster in a century. Record numbers of people have been affected. Now, tents have been settled in those areas, and we can say that now most of the people who live in these 10 cities are fearing to go back to their homes. So they are either sleeping in their cars or outside in tents set up by the local governments. And, we are waiting in fear, in a way, because we expect more aftershocks, but also with hope, hoping that many lives will be saved. In the coming hours.
One of the big things, even with the building behind her there, Melda, where she is reporting from, you can only hope that after the first shock, people were able to get out and didn't go back in. Maybe that's a saving grace. But Melda, thank you so much for being with us today. It gives us another idea. I mean, just think about that, everyone in Australia, for a second.
Yeah.
5,000 buildings. Imagine if that happened in a heavily populated one of our cities.
Absolutely.
And apartment buildings, everything falling down, having to deal with that on a mass scale.
And they would have all been home too. They were sleeping when this happened. It was the early hours.
Yeah.
And you can see just the resources at their disposal. I mean, they're doing this by hand.
There's few options for them. Yeah. The heavy machinery. I mean, they're not going to be able to get this heavy machinery in any large scale into these areas for some time. Plus, you can't do that anyway when you're sorting through wreckage like that.
No.
It's got to be gentle. Then you've got more tremors. You've got freezing cold weather. It's snowing. There's snowstorms on the way. And it's just every way you look, that's just another example of how violent it was so close to the surface. This earthquake and tremors subsequently have led to all this. Anyway, more during National 9 News through the course of the day. Welcome back to the show. It's just gone 12:30 at night in Turkey, where the injured are right now being airlifted to safety after two quakes struck the region.
At least 3,500 people have died in the natural disaster so far, although the World Health Organization says that may increase eightfold. As we go to where thousands of rescuers are digging through the rubble trying to find any survivors. Like this toddler, rescued from beneath a crumbled building in Syria. We will bring that to you shortly.
Well, on the ground, it's an awful situation, as you can see, with these rescuers. There's the pictures there.
I mean, there's
been multiple child after child being brought out of the wreckage. It's been done by hand. It's delicate work to try and get to those who are still alive. Agency reporter Dilara Hamit joins us now live from Turkey with more. Dilara, thank you for your time. Tell us where you are, what you're seeing.
Hello, hi. This is Dilara from Anadolu. Right now, we're at the epicenter of the earthquake at Kahramanmaraş. So, right now, this is a terrible scene. It took us about 12 hours to get here. It's normally, just for you to compare, it normally takes about 6 hours of drive to getting to Kahramanmaraş from Ankara, the capital. But the flights have been cancelled all around the country because of a snowstorm. So it's extremely difficult for aid, for journalists, for healthcare officials to arrive here because of a snowstorm. And the mountains are full with snow. Behind me, you could see a building that has recently collapsed. And several people have been rescued from here. And they have told us that people are actually still underneath and are being are being rescued right now. Officials have stated that around 2,300 people were killed and more than 13,000 were injured in 10 provinces after two strong 7.7 magnitude earthquake that jolted southern Turkey. But about 120 aftershocks has destroyed the buildings severely. So people here are desperately waiting for their loved ones. You could see, when you get closer to the wreck, you could actually see like personal belongings. That makes it even more heartbreaking. People cannot get back to their apartments or go to their neighbors or go back to their families because all of these apartments are under threat. They could go down any time because most of these buildings actually collapsed in aftershocks. Most of them didn't collapse during the earthquake. They collapsed after the aftershocks, and which is something that Turkish President Recep Tayyip Erdogan said was that this was the most terrible thing that happened to the country since 1939. The weather doesn't make it any easier. People are waiting around this fire for search and rescue operations.
And they're the lucky ones, Dilara.
We will update you with new events.
The scene behind you is utter.
They're the lucky ones. They're waiting for their family.
So, Dilara, I'm sorry with the delay and everything, but we're going to try and persist if we can. Those people nearby are waiting for their families. You've driven across a large part of the country and you've seen all of this destruction the whole way. It's nighttime, it's cold. What does the evening hold where you are for local people?
It's not looking good because the weather is extremely cold right now. It's raining right now, but most of the time it was mostly snowing. And most of the people here have been crying and complaining that not enough rescue has reached out. And we don't know what's going to happen in the morning. Many of them are still waiting desperately. We cannot imagine how terrible it might be to wait for a loved one under this wreckage. So Most of them are in a terrible situation.
And Dilara, you're on one side of the border, obviously, on the Turkish side. We know that this devastation has also struck the Syrian side of the border, and we know how much more difficult it is to get aid in a region like that that's been so devastated in recent times. I mean, can you paint a picture of us of what to expect over coming days for those people?
Honestly, I don't have much idea about what's going on in Syria right now because it took us so much time to get here. So I am not sure what's happening in Syria, but this is a place that's So Kahramanmaraş and Syria have just one city in between them, so it's Gaziantep. And so the epicenter is Kahramanmaraş, and Syria must have felt it extremely. So I'm guessing it's not as easy for them as well.
Yeah, look, and you've painted a picture of how difficult any kind of rescue, any kind of aid getting into the place is going to be. All that lies ahead tomorrow, I'm sure, at first light, where we get a bit better an idea. But we appreciate you being with us tonight and sharing with our viewers what you are seeing on the ground, which is truly horrible. Thank you for being with us.
Yeah, and stay well over there. Thanks, Dilara.
Welcome back to the show. More now on the situation in Turkey and Syria. We have heard from journalists on the ground, as you may have heard, that it's going to be really difficult to get aid and more rescue teams just into the disaster zone.
We want to bring in the CEO of World Vision Australia, Daniel Wordsworth. Daniel, thanks so much for your time. You've been in touch with your team who's on the ground at the moment. What have they told you?
Good morning, Carl. Good morning, Sarah. Yes, I was just talking to a colleague, actually a colleague that worked with us in Haiti as well. They're talking about a terrible situation. This earthquake actually struck a large section of Turkey, a large section of Syria. Thankfully, we already had teams there on the ground, and so we're able to respond. We're already working with people that have been affected by this crisis. But you have families that have been forced to leave. It's 4 a.m. in the morning when it happened. It's winter there right now. It's snowy. There's sleet rain. People are just trying to find a place to go. So you've got mosques filled. You've got actually people living in cars right now trying to get shelter. And we're trying to respond, and we are responding.
I mean, look, and particularly close to the surface to this earthquake. So it was very violent. And as you can see, with all the damage there to various buildings, some 3,000, we've seen these heartbreaking images of kids, the lucky kids, are being brought out, some of them in pyjamas. I mean, this is horrendous on a massive scale. How do you think you're going to be able to get in the coming hours, obviously, you know, 5 or 6 hours before any kind of daylight, how do you think you're going to get help in there? This is going to take months.
It's going to take months. Unfortunately, we've had to do this in the past. As I said, I've been personally involved in two of these earthquakes. It's incredibly difficult. You have people that are stuck in the houses, so you have search and rescue teams that are working desperately trying to get people out. You have people that are injured, and the injuries that you sustain in an earthquake are severe trauma injuries, so you have hospitals overwhelmed. We've heard that there are 30 clinics and hospital facilities that have been damaged by the earthquake, so they're struggling to respond. You then have families and small children in winter trying to survive and get through all of this. So you've got to be able to work at all these multiple levels in a place like this. And when an earthquake happens, I think what you sometimes don't realize is that the rubble falls into the roads. And so it's very, very difficult to actually get into these locations. And when you're in there, you're actually worried about buildings collapsing, like the one you're seeing right now, collapsing on you as you're working.
And we're also talking, Daniel, about a location in the Middle East that has been so fraught for the past few years. You know, we've seen so much conflict in that region. So already those hospitals that you speak about, any kinds of resources, they don't almost exist in regions like that. So it's an uphill battle even just to get the aid on a very basic level.
You've already got a region there, as you've said, that's just been overwhelmed by a humanitarian crisis that's been going on for almost 10 years now. So it's right on the border of Syria and Turkey. You have Gaziantep, you have Idlib, you have this sort of whole area. So we are working in three cities inside Syria and two cities inside Turkey. Mm. I mean, in a way, the silver lining, if you can and say that, is that organizations like World Vision were already on the ground. Our teams were already there because we're responding to the refugee crisis and the conflict inside Syria. Mm. So it means we're ready to go. But as you've said, the basic infrastructure was already strained. You already had a lot of people living there, and the cities were already overwhelmed.
We don't even know about basic necessities of life, about whether or not electricity is going to be able to be, you know, re-established. We don't know about water supply. We don't know about any of those things at this point. And you as an aid organisation, I know people in Australia are crying out to try and do something. Is there anything people can do here if they're worried, or even if they just want to help?
Yeah. Well, the good news is, you know, World Vision's your aid agency, and we're there. And so if you do feel generous, and if you would like to help, we are there right now. We're providing blankets, we're providing heating sources, we're providing things like tents and shelter. Already, right now, we're already doing that. And so if you could just go to our website and donate, we'd love it. And just be and rest assured we're there and we're doing something.
Okay.
Thanks so much for your time, Daniel. It is an uphill battle. I mean, you can see those pictures there. It's painstaking. They're literally using their hands and shovels to get through the rubble to try and find survivors.
We'll continue to talk to Daniel too over the coming days, I'm sure. And we'll be back with more of Today with Life in the Disaster Zone just after 9 o'clock this morning.